Can I interest you in horny furries? I kid, but consider this. RPG horror stories and weirdos who want to force their disgusting proclivities on other people who don't want it. Can you name a more iconic duo? We have a couple stories today, a story about a creepy edgelord and a story about a horny furry that tried to do weird suspect activities to his party member. I'm gonna put a content warning for those of you who are sensitive to non-consensual activity and assault. With that, roll post. There were certainly a lot of red flags before we got invested into this dungeon master. A group of friends found a DM on looking for game forums. His world sounded really thought out, though he did have a lot of rulings, and I mean a lot of rulings, before the game even started. Nearly a third of the classes were already banned, and only races allowable were D&D races from the 80s, and most of the variants were banned because they were overpowered. Okay, he did mention he wanted the characters to become heroes, not just start out at heroes. So maybe this is an epic tale where we will be Joe Schmo and kill a dragon a few years later. How we thought wrong. Things went south instantly. We joined for Session Zero, which was disregarded, and we were immediately put into a TPK situation. We roll a super lucky intimidation roll and get out. Wow, what a way to start. Our lives depended on a roll, 5 minutes in. Some other dramatic things happen in the next 15 minutes, and then we get into a town, where immediately, 30 women and children are killed and a huge big bad evil guy is pinned against us, who is level 8 or higher with all magical items and is screaming profanities. Well, we all almost died again, allowing him to slaughter the last woman. Man, two total party kills written into the first episode? Either this is just intense to get us interested, or something is seriously wrong. Something was definitely wrong. The fact that the party almost got annihilated twice in the beginning isn't really all that bad, so long as it was communicated that this was a hardcore game. Actually, extreme difficulty makes success all the sweeter. Now, the mass slaughter of women and children is more than I personally would stomach in my own games. But I'm not going to judge the DM as an awful DM for that reason. I'm going to judge this DM as one of the worst because of what he's about to do. We go to the lady's house who he killed. We rolled a nat 20 for investigation. He ruled that nat 20s always win for ability checks, but we still could not find the bomb under the bed that put a few of us to zero and gave us an incurable disease that will kill us in 5 days. We hobble back to the tavern where, guess who, the big bad evil guy is again pinned against us. Level 1's averaging around 4 HP. Can we get a break? Fast forward a few weeks where we actually did have players die, and we rolled at least a few dozen death saving throws. The first major boss rolled against level 2s, 4 8d8 spells which would have ended the campaign had we not had a few players sacrifice themselves, and the others rolling really well. It felt as if the game was set up for us to die very quickly. It was very cruel, and the players started growing distant from each other because of some of the decisions they had to make. The nail in the coffin was when a level 12 rogue almost one-shot our party member, and then forcibly used that person for pleasure. Holy hell. This is just one of those moments in Dungeons & Dragons where I want to rip my eye stalks out with my claw hands just for having read that sentence. It sucks losing a character. People naturally get attached to these characters that they create and design all on their own. People go on adventures and explore the unknown through this little spark of their own imagination, and every close brush with death makes them appreciate their character more. Losing your tune unceremoniously is a gut punch for sure, but to add insult to injury and do disgusting things to their lifeless corpse is the worst. However, if you think this is the worst it's gonna get, you're wrong. Roll post. This DM is obsessed with sexuality, and not in a good way. In all ways, bad, in fact. Every NPC rolled a seduction roll towards us, and if they passed, they tried to force themselves on us. Fortunately, most NPCs couldn't one-shot us, but then we were put into the exact same situation, only 2 sessions later in a tavern, where a female player character had the same thing happen. Well, we threw ourselves to the TPK, ready for our characters to die, and the DM actually spared us for the holidays. It's important to mention that we had 3 players removed from the campaign because they each missed 1 session. Charisma rolls towards the players should always be done carefully, if at all. If you're a newer or more inexperienced DM, I would personally just recommend avoiding them at all. But rolling persuasion on somebody's character takes away their agency and denies them the opportunity to make decisions. On top of that, sexuality is a sensitive subject, and including sexual themes, let alone full-blown sexual assault in games, is something you need to be even more careful about. I'm not gonna be the guy to police you and say you aren't allowed to do this or that, but most people want nothing to do with it in or out of games, so communication and taste are critical. I'm pretty sure I know why the DM is behaving the way he is, but we'll get to that in a bit. Back to the story. For the holidays, we told the DM that we would be out for 10 days between Christmas and New Year's, and he kicked us all out of the campaign and is currently trying to restart it on LFG forums. The laundry list of banned spells, races, classes, and feats, and subclasses should have been the biggest red flag. No, it shouldn't have. Him kicking 3 people out for missing 1 session, him rolling a D100 to see if an NPC will force themselves onto us sexually, should have been the nail in the coffin, but kicking us out for the holidays because we spent time with family will certainly have us all avoiding this DM for the rest of our lives. Okay, first of all, the most problematic thing was probably the corpse molestation, or the live person molestation. The banning was actually the best thing that DM ever did. Now, to why the DM is doing what he's doing, to the best of my knowledge, he's just a bully trying to inflict as much pain on people as possible. There are just genuinely crappy people. Some people that would go so far as to actually do things that are inherently self-destructive just to spite someone else. It happens. It's not a stretch to think that a DM would tank their own game just to lash out at some strangers. If he wanted a sexual campaign with people who were into it, he probably would have marketed it as such, but he didn't. Every D&D player knows that the vast majority of people don't play it as a rape sim. So, Dr. Crab's diagnosis. He's just probably a sadist lashing out at strangers on the internet. That, or there is something even more deeply wrong with him. That's just what I get from this. If the Crab Council has another proposition, I will open this discussion in the comments. For those of you with the mental fortitude or self-hatred to push yourself through that slog of a story, I present to you That Time My Friend's Character Almost Got Raped by a Furry Rollpost. Hello all, so quick introduction. I've been a player and a GM for many years and I've seen a lot of messed up stuff, but this is the one that has to take the cake to the point where my friend, who is a guy, will never play a female character again unless I'm GMing and he knows everyone in the group. Okay, story time. So we're playing Stars Without Numbers, which is an amazing system, I love it. My friend and I have spent the last 3 years building our own Stars lore and sectors, and we're up to 25 now, with factions fighting for control and all that good stuff. However, this takes place before that. And I was not the GM. It was a friend of ours that had never planned anything, but we wanted to play together because it never happens. We're going to call this friend GM, because he was the GM. I was playing a war robot made by AI to kill everything, but I was reprogrammed to protect the people on the ship. We had another guy who basically did nothing because he wanted to be the combat character, so he made a lazy space trucker as the pilot. No joke, that was his backstory. We're gonna call him Sleepy, because he was just asleep in the pilot seat when we got anywhere. my friend wanted to play a female scientist that was kind of a computer geek, so our characters could have some cool interactions. We call him Scientist. So we had gotten this mission to board a station and basically clear for our clients, so we did it, but it wasn't easy. And when we realized that Sleepy wasn't going to help, we asked the GM for another player, and, well, we got one. Boy, did we get a player indeed. So about GM. More, he was the kind of guy where you could play anything and everything regardless of setting, and he would approve of it. So our new guy was a furry. He was playing a purple dog, and he was the prince of his world. Because this doesn't work in Stars, he had said that his character was an alien, and he had an anime picture, and all that stuff to go with it. Now, to be clear, I don't care what people like, but none of us were furries, so how this guy got in was weird, I don't know. First off, I just want to have a little chuckle at the fact that OP doesn't seem to understand that furries are totally normal people that just happen to have a fursona or something. Like, how they just have no idea that this completely foreign, possibly feral, animalistic creature could just appear out of nowhere into their game. I'm not a furry, but I just find the alienation kind of funny. Back to the post. Three session rolls around, and the most we know about this guy is that he's a dog man. We know nothing about his backstory, which will later become an issue. So the session is going fine, we're doing some R&R stuff, and I was sitting in my mech that I had been doing some weapons testing in the hangar, while the scientist was in her lab examining some pieces of myself that I gave her. The furry starts making comments like, "Wow, your character is really hot, and I would lo-" I'm sorry. One sec. The furry starts making comments like, "Wow, your character is really hot, and I would love to hump her leg," and stuff like that. Nothing was said at this point, but it was really weird, and it was still, I was still early on in my tabletop adventures. Well, after some time, the scientist started to get weirded out and realized something was up. Okay, one second. I just want to know how long is meant by the phrase, "after some time." Because if someone says they want to hump your leg in an uwu voice, you should pretty immediately realize that something fucky is going on. The appropriate response would likely be something along the lines of maybe, "time out," or "this is weird," or "please stop." Obviously, there's a lot more story to get past, but OP's telling of these events are making this unintentionally hilarious. Roll post. Well, after some time, the scientist started to get weirded out and realized something was up. So she would start saying things like, "Oh, I gotta go see the robot to return this." Well, on his way, the dog made his move. This next part is really, and I mean really, messed up. Which is why I don't like furries and I don't allow crap like this in my games. This is your warning. So the dog cornered the scientist and pinned her down, and then started to tell us about his backstory. And keep in mind, he said this to her out loud, and he was proud of this. Okay, brace yourself. "Do you know what we do to human females on my world? We keep them in cages and breed them, and as the prince, I have the right to whatever female I want." The GM didn't do anything, so I did, and I stopped the game and said, "There is no way in hell you are about to rape someone else's character in the game." I straight up told the GM that this isn't happening, and if you allow it, me and Scientist are leaving right now, and we are never playing with you again. Appropriate response. Too often we see players or GMs who are just so desperate to play a game that they let horrible things slide. We see it on my channel all the time. It's a serious problem, so it's definitely refreshing to see somebody who isn't running the game stand up for their friend. Kudos. As far as the GM is concerned, they don't seem like a horrible GM, more that it just looks like they're too weak-willed and agreeable to stop people from being horrible. But as a GM, they have a responsibility to put a stop to it. That's the end of the question. So I'm gonna go out on a limb here and say that the GM has failed their party, but maybe they aren't beyond redemption so long as they learn from this mistake. April post. The GM agreed and said that it had gone way too far and that he needed to leave and that he wasn't welcome back. Later, we found out that the GM allowed him to have that backstory, and I railed him for it. I don't think OP maybe knows the meaning of the term, I railed him. Just a little suspect is all I'm saying. I railed him for it, and some of the stuff in his backstory was messed up. At this point, the campaign was over, and we didn't want to play. My friend was effectively traumatized and now refuses to play a female character anywhere but my games, because he knows that I will go off if that happens. I have a rule now in my games that sexual content is banned. You want to sleep with the women in the tavern? Fade to black, no more. And if you force the issue, I'm going to get rid of you. I don't care if players have in-game romance, so long as it's consensual, and I'll ask both of them. This has been the big theme of these stories, it seems. Setting expectations. Establish what you and your players want out of the game before it even begins, just so that everybody's on the same page and knows roughly what they're getting. And you're not going to get anybody acting way out of line, right? This is usually called a session zero. If you want to wash those horror stories out with a good story, I'll put it on the top right here. For more horror stories of terrible, awful stuff, I'll put it below. The choice is yours. Till next time.